Okay, we're back. We're live. We're here on Life in the Law on Wednesday at 1 o'clock. We are delighted to be here with Bill Gilardy, who is an attorney, and we're calling this show 40 Years of Real Estate, I guess Real Estate Practice. And I know him for most of that 40 years, I think.
Yes, you have. Yes, you have.
Welcome to the show, Bill.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Nice to have you here. I want to, you know, sort of introduce you and, you know, your career and the law practice as you have experienced it over these 40 years to somebody who, you know, doesn't know how law practice works. Some student, maybe. Somebody who might be considering becoming a lawyer. Or possibly somebody who is a lawyer and wants to know more about you.
Yeah. Well, practicing law has been to me just a gift. It's challenging. It's interesting. It's always different. It's never the same. And luckily, in our small jurisdiction here, most of the lawyers know each other, which means that the practice of the law is not nearly as vicious as it might be if you were in LA, because here in Hawaii, you're going to see the guy again. And the same thing is you're going to see the judge again. So everybody has a tendency to be a little more gentlemanly in the way they do practice. But
knock wood.
Knock wood. Well, that may change, of course.
It's not always the case.
It's not always. Oh, no, that's true. It's not always the case. But. Yeah, I originally came here from California. The first time I came to Hawaii was in 1969. I was a second lieutenant in the Army on my way to Vietnam, and the plane broke down. I grew up in Detroit. So Honolulu was obviously a completely different place than I'd ever seen before. So after I got out of the service, I went to law school at the University of California at Hastings and came to Hawaii in 1974, and I've been here ever since.
Wow.
I'm married to a girl who graduated from Kamehameha School, and I have, between us, we have seven children and a bunch of grandchildren, and we actually may be having a great-grandchild.
That's great, Bill.
So it's been fine, yes.
It really, I mean, it's great to be surrounded by family like that.
It is.
It's comfort in your elderly
years. Yes, it is. It really is. So what would you like to do? Want me to start just by who I worked for and what I did kind of thing? Or?
Well, first, why did you pick law? I mean, the choice then, see if you agree with me, it was different. Different considerations. It had a different feel about it then than it does now.
I picked the law specifically because I found it interesting. I have a bachelor's degree in accounting and a master's degree in finance, and we had planned to become a CPA. Or work for a large company as an accountant. In my last year in the military, I was stationed at Fort Ord, California, and they would take lieutenants, and they would become like paralegals. And I got to do a lot of that, court martials and things, and I just found it fascinating. I just thought, now this is interesting. So,
what is it in your makeup, in your bag of, you know, tricks? Your talents that made it interesting for you? I mean, what strengths did you have that you thought you could employ in this career?
Well, I think the two things I've always said is I like to talk, and I think very hard on things. Yeah. I'm not the world's greatest writer, but I can write.
Yeah.
And I just found that the idea of the law, it never is the same. It's always changing. No two situations are ever the same. They're always different. And you as a lawyer can know what I'm talking about. You can do the same kind of thing, but it's never quite the same as it was the time before.
Yeah. And you can't assume that because the fact pattern sounds similar or even identical, that the result is similar or identical. Yes. It could be completely different.
That's true. And the lat has a lot to do with just how a case or a particular matter works itself out.
The other thing that I would suggest for your consideration is that you're really good with people. You are really good. You have great social skills.
I enjoy that. I enjoy that part
of life. That had to be part of it, you know.
Well, I enjoy that part of it. I truly do. I enjoy people and meeting new people all the time, and I've really enjoyed meeting new people in Hawaii. Because when I first came, I was certainly, you know, I didn't know what I was really doing. And I always tell a story, which happened to me. there used to be a fellow that I worked for, and his name was Chico Gibson. And I know you remember who Chico was. And Chico, at the time, was doing a lot of work for the, what we then called the Bishop of State. We now call it Kamehameha Schools. And that was in the days before Kamehameha Schools or the Bishop of State really had any money. They had lots of land, but really no money. Now, most of the people today would say, never heard of that, that's not true. But,
they were land rich and cash poor.
They had no money. And what they had done for years was they would make these small leases, 3 acres, I mean, 3 acres, 5 acres, 7 acres, all over the state. And the first 10 years was free. And then the second 10 years, you had to pay. But during the first 10 years, you had to build a house and begin to farm or do something that would produce income. Well, as things will have it, everybody after the first 10 years didn't pay any money the second 10 years. So very soon after I got here, within the first year or two, I got the assignment from the Bishop of State trustees to file suit on all of these leaseholders that weren't paying. And the only place you could file a summary possession action, as you're aware, is district court. Now, the Bishop of State had land on every island except for Lanai. So within a year of coming to Hawaii, I went to every single district court in the state of Hawaii, which means I went everywhere in the state of Hawaii. There were many more district courts than there are now. It was an eye-opening experience, both from the standpoint of I went everywhere, I met so many people, and in those days I had real blonde hair and it was kind of long, and you know I didn't look like the local population at all. And I got to meet a lot of people. It's a really interesting thing.
Can you tell them about a district court in those days? You know, you said there were a lot more of them, but they were really country style, weren't they?
They were really country style, and really, I always laugh about the first time I went to district court in Honolulu. I had learned to have an ear for pidgin English. And the first day I went to court, I missed my hearing date because I didn't understand what the bailiff was saying. And I think you can relate to that. It took me a while to pick up the lingo and understand it. But the district courts were really, really interesting. It was all very informal. The judges would scold the defendants if they thought that they had done something they weren't supposed to do. And I remember one time I was in Kona, and there was this big Hawaiian guy, and he was a big man. I mean, he was, you know, 6'6" and weighed 350 pounds. And I was suing him. I was terrified, to be honest with you. And there was a judge over there named Judge Long, and Judge Long looked at him and said, the guy's name was Kimo. He says, Kimo, how come you not paid a bill? And Kimo very sheepishly came outside and paid me in cash. But they were all over the place. They were, and Molokai in particular was really wonderful. And one of the things I would do is, in those days, the planes didn't fly as much as they do now. So you'd have time to kind of look around. And so I got to look around a lot. And it was a wonderful experience. It really was.
Put you in touch with the people.
The people, yeah.
How the state really works.
Yeah, and
Neighbor Islands is how they really
work. Yeah, it really is. And it's much more informal. It's even today, it's more informal.
Yeah.
Because of safety and other things, we'd have to be a little more formal, but it's still compared to Los Angeles, I tell you. I can remember when, in the old days, it wasn't unusual for you because the judge had become your friend, you'd give him a bottle of booze for Christmas time. And that wasn't looked down upon or considered to be anything bad.
It was just style.
It was just the way things were done back in those days. Yeah.
So now that was early engagement for you, mm-hmm. and that was a particularly notable client, the mm-hmm. Bishop of State, then called the Bishop of State. That's really a terrific case to have, a terrific connection, terrific work, as it were. Yeah. Did that make you, did that help you choose real estate? as the area you wanted to stay in?
I think that no lawyers in a place as small as Hawaii picks an area of law that they want to go into. I think by circumstance, you get cases and then you start doing it. You are a real estate lawyer yourself. And you know that we all did a lot of other things besides real estate. I happened to work for a firm which is now called the Rushmore firm. And I did a lot of things and found out that I actually liked representing banks. And so at one time, I probably represented in one manner or form almost every bank in this town, usually doing loans problems or collection problems.
That is great. So and you were, had an accounting degree and a master's in finance. Mm-hmm. That was perfect. It all fell into place. You could teach them a few things.
With I did. And as a matter of fact, I did. I taught for about 15 years. I taught. The bankers had a bankers association.
Is that
and
right?
They would give courses for various things, and I taught for that for the bankers association for almost 2 decades.
That's
I guess.
A great way to develop clientele.
Well, it was also fun because most of the students were working in the banks. They were very anxious to learn, so you had very motivated students, and it was really a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And most of those people. Still recognize me to that day, you know, and most a lot of them have now retired. But
so, what was it like in the 70s, though? In fact, let me take a break first, and we'll come back, and we'll talk about that.
Sure.
You know, life in the 70s, practice in the 70s, as opposed till now. I mean, it's got to be a huge difference. Let's
sure.
talk about the difference.
Okay.
That's Bill Gilardy, attorney, 40 years of practice. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Ethan Allen, host of Likeable Science on ThinkTech Hawaii. Come join us every Friday at 2 p.m. when I interview interesting scientists about what they do, why they do it, and why we should all care about it. It's a lot of fun to see. We hear, and you can learn interesting stuff. You'll hear all kinds of fascinating science, and we know you'll have a great time. Hope to see you then. Bye-bye.
Aloha. This is Reg Baker, and I am the host of Business in Hawaii. We talk about positive stories of businesses in Hawaii, how they have been successful, and how they have overcome some of the obstacles that a lot of us encounter when we try to have a business here. And believe it or not, there are a number of positive stories here, and we want to talk to all of you. So we broadcast live every Thursday at 2 o'clock. And it rebroadcasts again on Olelo Channel 54. So I sure hope to see you next time. Please tune in on Thursdays at 2 o'clock. Thank you.
We're back. We're live. We're here with Bill Gilardy, attorney here on Life and the Law, every Wednesday at 1 o'clock. So talking about 40 years of real estate, except it wasn't all real estate. It was other things, too. So, Bill, we have a question on Twitter. High Living asks, can you tell us how your perspective of Hawaii as a lawyer has changed over the years since you first came to the islands?
Well, Jay, when I first came to the islands, I really didn't understand what was really here other than I thought it was a beautiful place to live, having come from the Midwest and the cold and all of those things. It became clear when I got here that there weren't very many lawyers. And in the 70s, when I first came, basically, you got to know every single lawyer who was actually out practicing law. You didn't get to meet some of them that were working in the big companies, or not all the guys who were working for the Attorney General or for the city. But the people who were out, you know, on a day-to-day basis, you know, in court, you got to meet almost everybody. It was really an interesting thing. Now that's changed dramatically. I still know all the older guys, but now at my age, which I'm over 70, all the judges are gone because most of the judges that we're on are now over 70, and you can't be a judge anymore. The next thing I think that happened, of course, is just the expansion of everything. You know, in the mid 70s, we were in a recession, and we had been through a big building around the state. We had all kinds of condominiums went up. And I think back in those old days, they were calling the crane the state bird, as I recall.
Yeah, right.
and it stopped for a while, and it didn't start again until the 80s. And now, if you look down by Ala Moana Beach Park, what used to be a little neighborhood when I first came here, Kakaako, that was filled not only with small businesses, but with lots of people. And they had an elementary school. You come to Kakaako today, it's a totally, totally different thing. And the final thing that's changed so dramatically is obviously technology. And I'm not sure I'm stayed up with it. I try my best. But in the old days, when you had work to do, you went to the books. You literally went to books. We had no computers. And as a young attorney, that was my job. I would be given a question from a senior lawyer to answer. For instance, you would ask me, well, what is inverse condemnation? Okay. And I didn't know what inverse condemnation was. I'm not sure I even know today. But I would then research that, but by going to the books. And slowly but surely, the young person doing the research for the older lawyer, that's kind of changed now, because the younger lawyers and the older lawyers actually do a lot of their own research themselves, because they become more technical and they understand the internet better. And of course, the internet itself has just made the access to almost anything, you know, that you want, you can find something about it. Maybe not be truthful, but you can find something about
it. No, I think that's a very important observation. Mm-hmm. Not only did the internet allow easier research, but because the research could be done not only by the young associates, but by the partner. It might be even more efficient for the partner to get on the machine himself.
Right.
This didn't really happen, in my observation, until maybe the 90s or maybe after
even,
the 90s.
Even after the 90s.
The 2000s,
actually. The 2000s,
yeah. That's 15, 16 years. But that changed the way law firms work.
Oh, tremendously. I mean, I can remember when I first came here in Hawaii in 1974, I did some work for a guy named Hal Conroy. And he was an older guy, and he asked me to come in because he wanted to talk to me. And when he was talking to me, he also had a secretary come in. And the secretary took notes in shorthand for what he was saying so that she could then prepare a memo to me. Now, needless to say,
that's not very efficient.
That's not very efficient. And then soon after that, we came up with dictaphones, which was actually quite efficient. That worked out pretty well.
Yeah.
And then eventually that went away, and everybody started typing their own stuff. And they didn't really need the secretary except for, you know, things that are done over and over again that it's much more efficient for a paralegal or a non-lawyer to do.
Yeah. You raise a memory in my memory about phone calls. You know, in the time, because we started practicing around the same time.
Around the same time.
In the firm I was at, which was then called Udell, Mukai, Wirtz, Ichiki, and Whitfield. You couldn't put that to music.
I know most of those names.
They had a receptionist, mm-hmm. who not only took calls and sort of, you know, transferred them to you, but she made calls, too. Mm-hmm. And the practice was, of course, if the call came in, it would come into the main number, not your direct line. People didn't have direct lines mm-hmm. at that
time. That's correct.
And she would bring your phone, and you would pick it up, and she would say that Joe Doakes is on the phone, and then you talk to Joe Doakes. Worse yet, I mean, in terms of efficiency, when you wanted to make a call, you would call her up on your phone, and you would say, Susan, would you please call Joe Doakes? Mm-hmm. And she would call Joe Doakes and then patch that through to you. Yeah. This was so inefficient, it was hard to believe. That's the way it was.
And then, of course, the advent of the cell phone.
That changed everything.
And the cost of making calls had changed dramatically. It went from very expensive to almost nothing.
Yeah.
And I can remember at one time I was criticized by one of my partners for not billing more time for my phone calls because I was using a cell phone and he wasn't. So, I found out that cell phone was something right away. I grabbed one. I said, this is really important. And they were big. They were like a brick almost. And you could only get, it was a dollar a minute to use them.
Wow.
So you didn't use them very much, but they were very, very efficient. And it's like a fax machine. I remember the very first fax machine we ever got. it cost $10,000. And that's like 30 years ago. So $10,000 would be like $30,000 now. And it was a big deal when we got that because it cost a lot of money. But it didn't take long, and it became very efficient and really helped, helped a lot, and particularly practices that were interstate. When you were dealing a lot with people on the main, a lot of insurance defense lawyers. It was a big thing for them.
Yeah, I don't think people today realize it's worth it to discuss this because it had a huge effect on the practice of law, the practice of business in the community too. Before the fax machine, without email, there was no email. When the fax machine came in, there was not yet email.
Right? That's correct.
So there was something called there was an ersatz kind of email that we used. And it was very strange. You would call them, I think, or you would write them, and they would print it out on their printer, and then they would hand deliver it. I mean, it was really
right. I recall it was
really
something
silly.
Like that.
But before that, it was mail.
It was really mail. It was truly, and I've always made kind of a joke about it. Is you can always not take the phone call, so you didn't have to take the call of whether you were in or you were not. And then now you have the cell phone and you have to answer immediately and give an opinion. So there's no lag time between the partner or the client asking you a question and getting back in a letter to them explaining what your position might be on.
So this speeded up the communications. You know, back in the mail day, you get a letter, it'd be days after the fellow wrote it, and vice versa. And then you would have, by virtue of this sort of concept, if he took, or if the letter took X days to reach you, then you had the same X days to respond to it.
That's correct.
So really, there was no immediate turnaround.
No, there was no immediate turnaround. But the old face-to-face conversations, that's never changed. I don't think that it ever will change, although a lot of people do so much with the internet. There's something about meeting with someone and talking to them directly that really makes a big difference in the way you do things.
But did you find that as the communication got easier with all this technology, that you weren't having as many face-to-face meetings?
Oh, absolutely.
Because it wasn't as efficient, because you could do fast turnaround.
Right.
And that the meetings you had were some quicker.
Quicker.
Yeah.
And everything moved faster, so you actually worked harder than you did before.
Yeah. More demand.
You were more, the demands were harder, and they are today. They are very, very, people have require things to be happening. And now that we have the whole system of electronic filings in the court system, that's really made a difference. I'm not sure for me for the good, but it's there, and you have to learn the system.
Yeah, but that actually takes me to a point I wanted to ask you about, which I'll tell you now what that point is, but then we'll take a break so we can think about it.
Okay.
Is it better now, or is it not so much better? When you take it all together, the sort of quality of practice, the quality, the satisfaction, you were getting when you first started, the realization of your expectations as a practicing lawyer, and now, is it a better experience, or maybe not so much? There are two sides on that one. Okay, Bill Gilardy, Life in the Law, 40 Years of Real Estate. We'll be right back.
Aloha. You can join the Hawaii Farmer Series every Thursday from 4 to 5 on ThinkTech.
And I'm your co-host, Matthew Johnson, here with Justine Espirito.
And we are so thankful to have this show to use as a forum to get to know all the movers and shakers in agriculture in Hawaii and hear kind of their background and history as well as
Their perspective on what they're doing and also the future for agriculture in Hawaii.
So join us every Thursday. You can tweet in your own comments and suggestions and be a part of the conversation at ThinkTechHigh. And we hope to see you every single Thursday.
Aloha. Hello, my name is Patrick Bratton. I'm host at Global Connections here at ThinkTech Hawaii. We broadcast live every Thursday at 1 p.m. We bring Hawaii to the world and the world to Hawaii, talking about international events and various things of interest to the audience. Please join me. I look forward to talking with you and having you get to meet some of my guests. Aloha.
Bingo, we're back. We're live with Bill Gilardy, attorney at law, more than 40 years of real estate practice here on Life and the Law. We're so happy to be able to talk to him and reminisce.
Thank you, Jay.
So, Bill, you know, my own point of reference is that if you wanted to go to Kaimuki for lunch, you could do that then.
Yeah.
And now is now, and it isn't the same. So many things have changed for the ordinary working stiff lawyer. Can you talk about it?
Yeah. I don't know how to put it, but when I started practicing law, if you wanted to talk to the judge, you went and talked to the judge, whether the other side was there or not. You know, maybe you were trying to work out a procedural issue or something. It was just very quiet. I mean, you didn't have to go through all of these taking off your belt and pants and all this other stuff. You know, I would say it was more gentlemanly. I don't know how to put it, because it was slower. It wasn't quite as fast. It seemed like more of a profession than it does now.
Yeah.
Because you worked from the books and you couldn't research like you could now. Now you can research the whole country, the whole world, and find cases in Japan that might have something to do with your what your issue that you're working on. That wasn't the same before. Same, you pretty much counted on what kind of law did we have here in Hawaii. A little bit of law probably from the East Coast, and always followed the trends that were in California. That's changed. Now people cite cases from any place around the world, literally. So it's made it much more hectic. The demands, I think, on the lawyers are much more. It's harder. No question to me about it being harder. And as you and I both know, when we first started, we were doing real estate law. We did a lot of other things too. But people are being able to narrow down like they do on the mainland, where somebody may do nothing but commercial leases. That's all they do. They do nothing but commercial leases. I don't think there's anybody in Hawaii that does nothing but commercial leases now, but there's certainly people in LA that's all they do. So it really changed it from it's a big change, and the demands are much harder. You work a lot harder than you used to work.
Yeah, but you know the bar has changed too. Those professional guys that you and I knew back when, they were very professional. They were in many ways kind.
Mm-hmm.
I remember Sam Landau, I don't know if you remember him.
Yes, I remember him.
He was a collection lawyer, and we had a case, and he said, come over to my office, let's settle this. So I went over to his office, and he said, I can see this right now as we speak, and he sat behind his desk, and he says, how much you want to pay my client? And I offered him, you know, a number that was the first offer, okay? I thought he wouldn't take it. He said, okay, we'll do that. I said, Sam, why didn't you take the first number like that? You know, you're a nice guy. Your client's not a bad guy. I don't want to hurt your client. Let's mm-hmm. just make peace on this. We'll work it out later. Next time around, you'll be kind to me.
Well, yeah, that's true. I remember I had a trial here probably about 5 or 6 years ago. And it was in district court. It was a small matter. It was over a possession of a pizza property. And so it had to be in district court. And the district court still is pretty loose with the way they do things. But I had a young lawyer on the other side who was trying to make a point that how good he was and that he was better than me and those kind of things. So the judge encouraged us to get a settlement, and so I made a settlement offer. And he wanted $500 more. I mean, it was ridiculous to ask for $5 or $500 in this case. And yeah, I said, I took it, but I would never have done that before. On years ago. I would have made an offer that was proper under the circumstances, and if they don't want to take it, they don't take it. But this guy wanted to get just a little tiny bit to show his client he could get a little.
That's
more.
An attitudinal change.
Yeah, it is. Definitely is. Yeah. It definitely is. Because the bar's bigger, and we don't know everybody like we used to.
Right. People have to prove themselves. Yeah, it'd be better. It's better the other way.
It was certainly. I think I got more done faster. The other way. Because you knew everybody. You were trying to. Since you weren't. You knew you would see that same man again, just like you were talking about Landau.
Yeah.
So you wanted to. You would get the best for your client, but you also didn't end up spending hours and hours of time fighting.
What's that worth?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And it seemed to me that the bills were smaller and the practice was easier, and the same result ended up at a much less price.
Yeah, but you know, didn't the profession do this to itself? I mean, for example, when you and I started practicing, you filed a memo in some motion or something, and it was like 2 pages long.
Much shorter, that's for sure.
Shorter. Now, you know, it has to be 70 pages or something. Right. And they're working all night and they're researching everything about everything. You know, as you say, the result might be pretty much the same as with 2 pages. Mm-hmm. You know, people aren't interested so much in justice as maybe they are in technicalities.
Well, I think that's true. And there's been here in Hawaii an awful lot more of just being rough and tough with one another that wasn't there before.
Yeah,
and I'm not so sure in the end run it helps the clients particularly.
Yeah,
but that's just the way it is now.
I've also felt that over the years, you know, because of this technology, you know, the point of the show, if you want to make a note about this, is the technology has had more of an effect on the practice of law than anything, and every change that you can identify is wedded to some technology that came into that.
That's exactly just like I was telling you about the dictating to your secretary, then using a dictaphone.
Yeah.
Same thing. If you can look through an old file, I looked at an old file that started back in the 40s one time, and everything was on tissue paper that had. And then it went to old types of machines that the paper was real hard and was cracking and falling. And you can see through the years in that file the change in the technology. It was a real estate deal.
Like the rings of a tree.
Yeah, it was really amazing to where we are now.
Yeah. And even while we practice, you know, you can watch the technology growing.
It's growing at a fantastic speed.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really.
Now, you've been in big firms and small firms.
Yes.
You've seen it in all the sizes. And you know, I've observed them. I wonder how you feel about this. Is that then, early on, big firms were powerful because they could afford whatever the newest technology was.
Right.
But over the years, anybody can afford that technology.
Anybody can afford that technology. Yes, and that does make the smaller guy more powerful. The large firms also did something else. They had the money to hire the best people out of law school. And so you got real motivated people out of law school. Others, you know, had to go to work at anything they could get because they may just be just as smart as anybody else. But the big firms were able to kind of get the cream of the crop, so to say.
So everybody wanted to be with a big firm.
So everybody wanted
money
to be
was
with
better
big.
And all that. And
money
your
was
prospects
better, and
were better.
And the learning experience was better.
Yeah, because you did all that research, you were learning.
And plus, you had the other older lawyers to talk to.
Yeah.
One thing about lawyers, and I think you'll agree with this, lawyers talk, at least in Hawaii, lawyers talk to each other all the time, whether on opposite sides of the case or they're asking somebody's opinion who maybe does the same type of work they do. And that's very, I think that's slowed down a bit. It's not quite, it's not done as much as it
There was a time, there was a, you know, I remember my own experience, like with Sam Landau, that I had this kind of avuncular relationship with them. They were going to help me, mm-hmm. even though they were adverse, they were going to help me. They were going to be kind
to me. Oh, yeah. I mean, that's just the way it was. I can remember years ago, there was a fellow, his name is Doug Ng. He eventually became
one of the trustees
of the Bishop of State, and he and I took the bar together and became great friends. We were both ex-military officers. And he worked at that time as a clerk for the judge, I think it was Kawakami, who was the motions judge.
I remember that.
And
he did.
And he and I decided that there was no file anywhere that you could go and get a motion for this or a motion for that. And so he and I decided to put together, from him being the clerk, every kind of motion. Well, we never did publish it like we had intended to. I think technology caught up, and maybe our law practice has got too busy, but that's something I don't think people would ever think of today.
Yeah. You know, that's a very interesting sort of delta point. In those days, early on, if you wanted to do a motion for this or that, you know, there was no form around. You'd have to go and call people.
Right, or ask partners in the firm that you were in, did you ever do anything like that? And they would say, well, I sort of like that, but, you know, in those days, I can't remember the number of volumes of the Hawaii Reporter, but I think it was in the 40s or the 30s when you and I started practicing. There was hardly any law at all.
Yeah, yeah. And it was always, well, what does Hawaii law say on this point? Well, it hasn't said anything on this point.
Right, all that happened
there is
all
no
the time. It happened all the time. And then you could go anywhere you wanted to. And, of course, if you wanted to find something that said anything you wanted to, you go to the middle courts in Texas. That's, as I recall, the Court of Appeals of Texas. Well, you could always find a case that said anything you wanted.
Active state.
Yeah, right.
So, Bill, looking forward, I guess I'm interested in two thoughts. One is, you know, if you project this trajectory that you have seen over 40 years in real estate and all kinds of changes, where are we going here in the state and in the practice in general? You know, one trend, I think, you mentioned in the break, that real estate law hasn't changed that much.
No.
But the practice has changed.
Yes.
And the players have changed. The capital concentrations have changed.
Yeah, when we started, you and I started, Most of the work that was being done, that the building of buildings, the residential subdivisions, and you know all that kind of stuff, was being done by people who were from here. I'm not saying they were born and raised here, but they had come here and this was their home, and they were here, interfacing with the people. Slowly but surely, that has changed. Today, if you go down to, you know, Alamoana Boulevard and see all those things going out, I guarantee you, there'll be some local people, but for the most part, that's all money from the mainland or Korea or Japan, and to a little bit degree now, a little bit of money from China. And they don't do business like we do business, or we did business. We've been Sweden sort of forced to do business the way they do business. For instance, you know, I've been kind of talking to a bunch of people since I knew I was going to be here. A lot of people are very interested. Well, what's our market like? You know, the real estate market here, whether you be in residential or you be in commercial, has gone through the roof as far as cost. And in checking with a few people, at least in the residential area, the amount of houses available for sale is very low. So I don't see us taking a 2008 problem with a you know, prices going very down, at least in the next year or two. Same thing with commercial. The commercial stuff seems to be staying the same way. Now, I don't know if we've overbuilt down there. I don't know if we built for the average person this so they can afford an apartment. I don't know if we've done that, yeah. But it certainly has changed. It's the localness of it, the Hawaii part of it seems to be fading away.
Yeah, in all aspects of it. For example, Ala Moana, that's owned by an offshore company,
right?
General Growth. And the developers of those big, four or five condos there along the water, they're building them right now. That's, you know, offshore developers.
For the most part, yes.
Yeah. And even the labor, I think they're getting a substantial amount of labor from offshore.
Yeah, I think they are, because we simply, in a lot of cases, may not have the skills, some of our people just don't have the skills, or there's not enough of them to handle the work that
we've done. The magnitude, yeah.
Yeah.
And then the guys who come and buy these condos, they're offshore.
A lot of them, though, although in some of the ones, maybe in the last 5 years, for instance, there was an awful lot of older people who had nice homes in the nicer areas
sold their homes.
And they sold their homes for a lot of money, and they were able to buy these really fancy condominiums because they didn't want to still take care of the yard and all of those things.
Yeah,
so there's, I saw a lot of that being done. But now, you know, a lot more Koreans are buying, Chinese are buying. Chinese not so much right now, I think, because their economy's a little funny, but it's definitely changed. I mean, there was one time, I remember, we used to have all kinds of Canadians buying the condominiums.
Yeah, that's not happening anymore.
That's long gone, that's for sure.
And then the lawyers, you know, over the years, a lot of mainland lawyers hired by mainland capital interests here have displaced local lawyers doing large projects. So the, you know, the size of the case, so to speak, that a local lawyer would do is different.
It's very different, because an awful lot of the, for instance, if you're going to have to go between the land border, you're going to have to do something with zoning. They'll use a local lawyer to do that. But as far as dealing with the contracts for the overall deal, they may not hire somebody from here.
Yeah, and that's changed the practice. So what is your practice now, you know, in your pre-retirement years?
Okay, I do a number of things. I represent small businesses and do litigation involving problems that they do. Mm-hmm. I've taken up doing some foreclosure defense work, helping out poor people. You get a little older, you get a little softer.
Very nice of you, yeah.
And most of it has to do with real estate, one way or the other. I mean, that's been kind of the core of business here in Hawaii for a long time. Mm-hmm. And try and take a little bit more time to spend with my grandchildren. And I have a farm over on the Big Island that my wife and I go to, and it's very enjoyable.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, how sweet it is in Hawaii. So, there's camera two, and all those kids, they need advice, Bill.
Okay, good.
Do you advise them to go into the practice? Should they go into real estate? What would you tell them?
I tell them yes. It's still an exciting way to spend your life. I always remember it when you first started practicing law, if you were in any other business, you would be meeting with somebody your own age who is also beginning. As a lawyer, a young lawyer, you got to meet the more senior people in the industries right away, and that made it so much more interesting. You know, like going to law school, I had no idea what law school was going to be about, and I always remember describing the law school and learning about these things. It's like you're in a big building and you have no idea how the building functions, and somebody said, well, go down there and open up that door in the basement, and you open up this door just a little bit, all of a sudden you see all the things that make a building work. And that's the law. All of a sudden the law is what you learn very slowly, how it functions. And as everybody wants to say that it's not functioning well, it functions better here than any place else.
Yeah.
And I've enjoyed my career as a lawyer, very much so. And I would always, if someone has the interest and has the gumption to do the hard work, because practicing law is not easy. It's very hard, but it also comes with tremendous rewards.
Thank you, Bill.
And I don't mean money. I mean rewards of the soul and the brain.
And understanding the human condition.
Yes, it is. It's really, really is, particularly here in Hawaii.
Thank you, Bill Gilardy, attorney, 40 years of real estate practice here in life and the law. Thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me, Jake.
Aloha.
Okay, good. Thank you.